welcome to the third episode of the Pink Fox Playhouse.
Hi.
We're here in Washington, D.C. at Listen Vision Studios. Thank you so much for joining us, those of you who are in the studio. And if you're watching online right now, thank you so, so much for joining us. All three of us are here. Keo's here. Oliver's here. Ronan's here. sorry about that. I know, it's so terrible. Ronan's here, though. So thank you. Thank you so much. It's good to have you back. I know we missed you last week, man. I hope you had a nice trip. We had a pretty good episode.
Yeah, it was really good. We had good.
So what did you talk about?
Well, that's what I was just about to tell you. You missed our man Bronson, who was in here. He is part of the all male review that's coming to Washington D.C. Mm-hmm. The burlesque brunch, I think it is.
It's brunch. Yeah, there's two showings every day, but they're around brunch time.
Where at?
That's a good question, but it got written up in the Washingtonian. There's a lot of buzz about it now, and so he tried to downplay it last weekend. He's a table stud at the all male review.
Stop.
Yeah, which is
define that term.
We're not sure what it means.
That's what I see. But he tried to underplay it like it was no big deal.
So the words table stud came out of his mouth, and he thought it was cool to just like gloss over it.
I think he's going to put that on his W-2 next year, too. Table stud.
That's big on the resume, I'll tell you that.
He was great. And then we had our guy, Money Mike, who debuted his latest rap video, Came Up. That was the name of the video. We'll link that on our website this week. Actually, I meant to do that or post it on Twitter. Local artist. He had a great video. He's doing some great things. I'll have to share that with you. Make sure.
Absolutely, yeah. That's a great name, by the way.
Yeah.
That's a great. Isn't that an homage to?
You would think Floyd, right?
No, Money Mike from Friday After Next.
Oh, see when I hear money in the name, the first thing, Team Money, Mayweather, that's the first association I always make. So, but if you're trying to find him, it's I Am Money on the Mic. Mm-hmm. I Am Money Mike. That's what it is. I Am Money Mike. Like I said, we'll put his video up from last week. We'll tag to that again. They were really great to have in studio. They were a lot of fun.
Oh, very interesting story.
Totally hilarious, yeah. And respect the process was their hashtag, so make sure to follow that. Twitter, Instagram. They're doing like a
hashtag.
Respect the process. It's kind of like a social media mental health campaign. So like when you have a bad day, you can go to that hashtag and see people that are like, tackle that small problem. Tackle the small step. You
I'm
know,
with them.
Yeah.
Awesome.
No, it was really beautiful. Cool. It was really nice of them.
Like you're not the only person.
Going through
a wellness hashtag.
Yeah, exactly. So now that we have you back, though, let's do our show. The third episode of Pink Fox Playhouse. The first one got hit with a couple copyright violations.
Yeah,
so again, if you're trying to watch it, I hope you're in Canada. And if you are in Canada and you are watching it, let us know. but the second episode went up with no problem. Big thank you to our producer Mike Phillips for filling in, playing some of that smooth jazz.
Like CD 101.9, New York.
Smooth jazz. No,
the Key Sweat.
That episode is online right now on the WLVS YouTube page, and then we'll have that link to ours as well too. Let's get into it. Let's start with current events. There's about 15 of them cover. So let's choose one. I think the one everybody's talking about right now, it's an NFL story. If you don't know it, San Francisco 49ers quarterback Colin Kaepernick has decided to take a knee. Now he's taking a knee. He had originally sat during the national anthem. Yeah. Now he's taking a knee during the national anthem. I know there's some kind of discussion about why he's doing it, and there seems to be some disagreement, or like maybe he's not been clear enough about why he's doing it. Jason Whitlock, who's a big sports reporter, kind of gave him a hard time last night after their preseason game, saying that he wasn't clear enough about his motives. I feel like the motives are pretty clear.
I'm fairly sure.
No, that's what I mean. So, yeah. I know we were talking about this in the pre-production meeting. No hot takes, but any real takes on it? Do you have an opinion on what he's doing?
I'm with it.
Yeah,
I can't tell a man not to express his feelings on this. Like that's the whole issue has become. It's pivoted to free speech, right? Which is awkward because that's not what his problem is. But I mean, well, that's what it comes down to.
Some people feel like he might not be as entitled to this opinion because of the amount of money he makes. And he makes it in this... You know what I mean? Like, that's what I'm saying. Like, these arguments are, yeah, but, are counter to... You know what I mean? Oh, exactly. I mean,
just no.
No, like, exactly. You're still entitled to an opinion.
Yeah, you should be socially conscious regardless of what your tax bracket
is. Well, let me ask you guys this, because the only situation I could really think of to you know, I try to always, you know, draw on something else, right? Like, compare this to something else. I thought of John Carlos, you know, in the Olympics, and that was a national anthem. He made his protest very clear. I'm going to forget the gentleman who came in third place who participated in the protest too. But I mean, that was an iconic image, one that's always
on my
stuck
wall,
with
all
me.
Through high school.
I was going to say it has always stuck with me. It's such a beautiful image. You know the one I'm referring to, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Gave a Black Panthers. I mean, you would consider it a Black Power, Black Panther salute during the ceremony for the 100 meter, I think it was.
So here's the issue, though. I think that what Kaepernick's doing right now is really reminiscent of that, which at the time was
a civil rights movement.
Right. It was a much, I want to say, more scandalous kind of moment in time to be making those statements. Right now, people make statements about what they want every day through Twitter, Instagram, Facebook.
140 characters,
whatever.
Right?
Yeah. Like, I mean, and it's like opinions that don't really matter. Like, no one cares. So. Yeah. For him to get up and have an opinion that's like worth something, well, and for people to come back so hard, it's like, come on, guys. Let's...
And it's an opinion that he has on a platform, on like this huge platform, right? That leaves him open to scrutiny, unlike, you know, a lot of other people. You know what I mean? He performs.
I'm with the scrutiny too.
Oh no, I totally am.
If anything, he's only like broadening the awareness
of this issue.
Somewhat of this issue.
And he's made a donation too, I believe, just this week to underprivileged communities, you know, those who are, you know.
What did he donate his hair?
No. Well, let's talk about that. He, you know.
Let's talk about how he looks like a biracial form of like one of those Spaceball dudes.
Well, I'd also like to talk about how it got
Dark Helmet
so
Kaepernick.
Big. I mean, that was a chia pet that, you know what I mean? I don't know how he grew it. He had a, you know.
One day at a time, brother. Like, don't man.
But I feel like it was almost like Iverson letting the braids out. You know what I mean? Where did all this hair come from all of a sudden? And where are you hiding it under the helmet?
I think Kaepernick was letting everybody know in case he forgot.
Yeah. Well, you know who forgot? Rodney Harrison.
Yeah.
Did you see those comments?
Look, man, I've seen a lot of comments.
Yeah.
Let's
of course,
be real.
Yeah,
that whole comment section is. Yeah. Probably the worst.
I think
America.
These all sound like things that somebody who's not playing very good football does.
So are you taking a shot at Cap?
Well, I don't know.
I think
maybe
that was a direct shot,
like,
across the bow.
Maybe he isn't focused on his game and
he's
focusing
this.
On other things,
when
and maybe
came,
that's detrimental to the team.
When he came into the league, I couldn't get behind him because I really was. I was digging Alex Smith. I was happy that he was finally finding his place in the NFL. Cap explodes onto the scene when Alex Smith gets injured. And, I mean, dominates. You can't say anything other. He ran the best read option in the NFL that anyone had seen for a couple years. And he had a great coach with him, too. Harbaugh was an unbelievable coach. It's a different team now. And, yeah, he's a different player. But I still really respect and support him through this.
Yeah, I'm gonna stick to the issue.
Yeah, yeah. Versus his
like,
on
I
the
mean,
field.
Yeah, I mean, I get it. Like, okay. Yeah, maybe he does have a little bit of free time now.
Well,
in
I mean,
any
is
case,
he
this is a bad way to spend it.
My argument as his employer would be: are you focusing on the game? Are you focusing on your statements right now?
My question, as an individual who's
getting,
living in this world, is: can I focus on the game right now?
That's all.
Like,
there
really,
you go.
Straight up.
There's
a lot going on. A lot going on in the world.
That's a service.
Oh, that was served up. Yeah,
well, there's always
serve.
Things going on in the world. People have to perform. They have to step up to challenges when things are going on in the world.
Yeah,
are you saying that we get to a point where we can't perform anymore? That we have to, like,
that
shut
seems
down?
A little bit extreme.
Well, not that you can't perform. Not that you can't perform, but that your performance, like, if your performance is something that draws the attention of X number of people, you're obligated to do something with it. I mean, like Spider-Man's uncle said.
With great power, it's great responsibility.
Oh, I mean, you just can't help it.
It's time to move on.
Yeah, we'll move on to the next story. Do you want to stay in the football realm? We have another football story, kind of about Lena Dunham and Odell
Beckham
Jr.
I just read this.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's kind of a crazy
break
story.
That down, please.
I don't understand it, honestly.
Yeah, I think that it really comes down to she kind of jumped the gun and put some words in Odell, tried to put herself in Odell's shoes.
Put in all of him. I don't understand where these thoughts came from.
But yeah, she spoke for him, said that he couldn't have been more uninterested in looking even at her because of what she was wearing, the way she looked, her body type, all these different things. I didn't see Odell even acknowledge the statement, get a chance to say anything before she had issued, you know, a 3-page apology.
I'm curious, like, did she try and strike up a conversation with him?
No. That's what she was saying.
What was the basis of this
situation? So she felt like he had his phone out doing whatever, you know, an awesome athlete, star, A-lister does.
Scrolling through Instagram.
Right? Yeah. Checking the DMs. And sure she didn't like that. She felt like he was disgusted by her presence, and he gave no indication as such. That was something she had totally made up on her own.
So it sounds like more just general ambivalence and or like not giving a fuck.
What, I mean, I think she just jumped the gun. Yeah,
I don't
no,
understand,
none of us were.
Like,
but if she felt the need to issue an apology for speaking for him, you know what I mean? It's just like it's funny coming from her too.
I saw that there was an apology issued, but what did she apologize for?
For the things that she said.
Everything.
She had said Odell could not have, you know, he was disgusted by, you know
was
what
she
I mean?
Doing kind a of making bit? Him, was it funny?
No, I think she was being quite serious. Yeah,
serious.
Like that she felt out of place at the Met Gala, you know, being who she is and being who all the other celebrities were. But I mean, that's the funny thing about Lena Dunham though too, is she, and I think that's why she felt the need to apologize. She is a big advocate, you know, for those people without a voice, you know what I mean?
I want the facts. I just want to know
exactly,
like,
yeah.
What did Odell
and it seems
say,
crazy,
or,
right? Yeah.
It seems like he's almost like made a whole statement by not making any statement at all to her, and that that's a little awkward.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, but also too, like, I can imagine, like, what are you supposed to say, right? Like, to something that you had no idea.
Maybe
that this
she wanted him
felt.
To be like, "Yo, I watch Girls. I love your show." Like, I don't. Maybe he didn't say that. And
have you seen a lot of that show?
I've never seen an episode. I'm gonna be straight up with you.
I haven't either. Ronan,
what
I
channel does
either.
It come on?
Oh,
come on!
You know it's on HBO.
Oh, so
it's the home box office.
Yeah, okay. You're right.
Come on.
I saw her
independent movies, the short films that she had made, Tiny Furniture, and the other one's escaping me. I think she's very talented. I think she's a great writer. She obviously knows what she's doing. It's just funny to see her kind of, you know, put her own foot in her mouth, you know what I mean? Because
I feel like she's done that before. It's not the first time she's done that, right?
See, I don't pay too.
Well, it seems like maybe she, I mean, she has a lot of feelings about this, and that's
cool.
Since
we launched our radio show, she hasn't, so.
Okay. in the last 3 weeks?
Yeah, in the last 3 weeks. Woo, so,
well,
yeah.
I think we should look forward to having a Lena Dunham segment every three or 4 weeks for when she
we
does
should,
something.
Like, what's Lena
Dunham done? What's the dun dun?
We'll get it. Oh.
What's the dun dun?
The dun dun?
That's terrible.
That was
That's
pretty
terrible.
Bad.
And on that note, we'll move on. Well, so we'll keep it in the realm of current events and things happenings. The VMAs were last week. That's something that we all used to look forward to, but now kind of only fast forward through to see our favorite performances.
I think the option to do so probably makes it a little more prevalent.
Accessible?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well,
viewership was down this year.
Viewership was the lowest it's
ever been.
Well,
there was about 17
honest.
Hosts.
I assumed that I was just going to check it out later. Like, I was going to let
you're
it
gonna
run
check out the,
and
the,
then just hit the highlights, man.
Well,
like
the BuzzFeed 17 things you need to see from the VMAs, right?
BuzzFeed, UpRocks,
yeah,
they had me
yeah,
on
someone's
VMAs.
Someone's
going to
do something.
Right, exactly.
It was kind of a Rihanna show. Rihanna performed 3 times.
A full three.
It was the Rihanna concert. I think she was proposed. She was proposed to at the VMAs too, by
Drizzy. Yeah, he's trying to lock that down.
I think Drake gave her a varsity pin and you know, crowned her prom queen. And
hey, man, after 3 performances, she needs something.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
Yeah, it was. I mean,
good for her.
I thought she did a great job. Yeah. It's tough to follow Beyonce. I feel super bad for Britney Spears.
So I saw Beyonce. Everybody should feel bad for Britney Spears.
I just can't.
That was,
I think,
so
like
she thought
Britney
she was the headliner? Is that
the
word?
The story is Radar Online reported that MTV sold Britney Spears on being, you know, the big headliner. You got the Vegas show. You just did Carpool Karaoke.
Did she
karaoke.
Know Beyonce was going to be there?
That's the thing, is like, people want to know how they thought that performance was the headlining performance when Beyonce does like one song for 22
she's
minutes.
She's got to have people that she pays to just like know.
No, I think that's what happens.
Hey, Beyonce's
going to
be
anymore.
Here. Beyonce's going to be here. Drake. Almost anybody in that audience eclipses Britney Spears at this point in
hey,
time.
People that are on the radio today, they're here. So it's super crazy. The only guy we couldn't get is Frank Ocean. And that's because he's writing his next like. His
he's
next
really
like
busy.
Anthology, you know, novel that comes with the album.
Speaking of Frank, that that was a great magazine.
Yeah, it was a great magazine. It. Yeah, it was. I haven't finished the magazine all the way through, and I haven't finished the Lemonade video
poems?
That he did.
McDonald's?
Yeah, but the album, it was okay.
Okay.
It was. I thought Channel Orange was a lot better, but I liked a lot of this album. I did. I liked a lot of Blonde.
I think this album has a time and a place.
Sure. And can I tell you what's the most impressive part about this album? Did you see the Billboard story about how he got it made?
No.
He owns every single print, like every single master to this album. He's getting all the money for it.
Because he negotiated with Apple, right?
He got the Apple deal, yeah. And then he bought himself out of the Universal Music deal.
But because he did the Endless Music video beforehand.
Exactly.
Yeah,
no one has seen any move like this before. They're calling him like the Uber of music for like changing the game.
Well, yeah, UMG wasn't happy.
No,
they
thought about
statement.
Suing him because they have this, now they have a Frank Ocean album that they can't release because Blonde is just like kind of artwork, you
right.
know? So it's a funny situation. Those are the current events. We're going to take a quick commercial break. We're going to go into our first commercial. When we come back, we'll have our first guest, Chloe Sommers, will be here. You've probably read a ton of her articles. You've
yeah.
seen her all over the place. And she's launching her own radio show here at Listen Vision Studios. So we'll be talking to her next. Thank you for joining us, the Pink Fox Playhouse.
Oh,
the third episode of the Pink Fox Playhouse here at Listen Vision Studios. To bring you guys up to speed, that is our Red Rocks that you are seeing pictured on the screen there. It's a gluten-free item. Kia, you want to describe it for us real quick?
Oh, it's a kind of twice-baked item that is infused. Starts out with corn chex, rice chex, a little brown sugar, a little bit of butter, but you mix up the butter and the brown sugar. You cook it together to almost a caramel, and then you spread it all over your chex mix, and then you sprinkle it with cinnamon sugar, and you bake it,
it's
and
delicious.
Then you flip it, and you bake it, and then it turns into this delicious, crunchy,
churro brittle,
so good,
impossible
gluten-free.
To stop eating.
And this is our guest, Chloe. Thank you so much for
Thank
joining
you
us
for
today.
Having me.
What's up, Chloe?
I'm so glad that you guys have your own show. I love you. You're more than just, you know, a business. You're characters. You know,
thank you.
Yeah, no, I'm glad you guys have a voice here.
We're really glad you could join us, and we're excited you could join us because you have such an active voice in the community.
Thank you.
How did that all get started? How did you get started writing, even?
Good question. Well, I went to school for journalism. I worked for CNN for six years.
Wow.
So I was pumping out stories on Hillary and Trump and Obama for
right
a long time,
Very
long
cool.
time. And
I can see why that could
get,
you know,
really
yeah.
quickly. So exactly about a year ago, I was like, I saw the storm coming and
oh, wow.
the Hillary and Trump train. I was not going to board.
Okay.
I just let it go and I stayed at the station.
Well, so smart.
I'll tell you a little story. One of the very first normal meetings that I went to here in D.C., I met you. And you probably don't remember it. It was so long ago. And you're like,
eh. It was probably my first
it,
one.
I think it was. It was maybe
that
your first
was a great
one.
Way
and
to
you
get
gave me your card that
oh,
night.
Good.
I was like, right on. So
I didn't know. Yeah, that was the beginning of all of this. I really suggest anyone looking against the cannabis industry to go to your local advocacy groups,
mm-hmm.
the DC, the Normals, yep. the Women Grow, the what else? Who else? I remember.
NCIA has
NCIA,
a court,
NCIA,
yeah, great
them.
Meeting. And those
trade
are some great people. Yep.
Trade group
yes.
organization.
Yeah.
Those are all the places I went first.
And NCIA, National Cannabis Industry Association, by the way. I don't mean to use acronyms and
oh,
sound hip,
them,
like I
yeah.
know what I'm talking about. But
but it's great because you meet people and we met down the road. But, you know, you get a feel for who's in the community and where your area of expertise, like where you can fit in. That's the best part about it.
And you kind of learn it's not a small community, too. There is a lot of different
like
people.
It's like rings upon rings of just groups of people. It's nationwide. It's international. I mean,
yeah.
Phone Homie, who has a show here on Saturday, he was just got back from Poland and
he
was doing the cannabis tour there.
And it's so fun to follow his stickers around the world, too. You know what I mean? Those stickers are international,
and
too.
And it's a great sticker.
Oh, the videos. Yeah,
the
he has a great
video. The bathtub
video
in a day. Oh, my God.
Yeah. Well, speaking of series, you've got some great pieces of writing
Thank
at some
you.
Really, really great, you know, publications. Leafly is one of them.
Yes.
The latest one
That's
I want to say that known. I saw is the Marijuana...
Marijuana Times.
Marijuana Times.
MarijuanaTimes.org. I'm their senior writer.
Wow, congratulations.
So it's really great because I have leeway to just write whatever stories I think are most important. And being in D.C., people don't really realize we do have recreational,
mm-hmm.
we do have medical.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have, you can't purchase. There's no structure for purchasing
sure.
Recreationally. But we're in the backyard or front yard of Congress.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's a national conversation that goes right through this city. And we also have our local flair, which is lovely, which you guys really represent very well.
Thank you so much. Well, so I'm going to take the opportunity. We have the opportunity to pick the brain of a senior writer
yes.
here.
Yeah.
What are those stories that are important right now? Like, what if we're watching the
Number
show
right one
now?
Story
yeah,
right
like
now.
what do we need to care about right now?
Well, I'm about to come out with a 3-part series.
Oh, exclusive! We had an exclusive last yeah. week. Here is our second
third,
exclusive.
Week three.
Yeah, back-to-back exclusives.
Yeah, it's really just laying out what I see is ahead of cannabis
okay.
in the future. So it starts with a breakdown of the plant as we know it.
Okay.
You know, grow a little on your own. That's
sure.
what Normal always says. And I really agree with that because I really see the pharmaceutical companies, the therapeutic kind of companies focusing on recreating fake molecule synthetics.
Well,
Mm-hmm. And that's the direction that the FDA and Big
yes.
Pharma are in. And so my 3-part series breaks down the differences and what's involved in that, what's involved in FDA, you know, when they consider a drug and how long it's going to take. Yep. And then the third part is also political implications. Hillary Clinton's accepted $1 million from Big Pharma, yet on her campaign website, it says that on campaign finance, she wants to be transparent.
Yeah.
And number two, that she actually has steps to take money out of Big Pharma. She said, here's how we can cut prescription drug costs, which is good.
Yeah.
But when you have $1 million of Big Pharma in your pocket and you're trying to cut into their profits, I don't see the transparency there.
It's tough to say.
Well, the transparency is there, but is the action actually going to happen because of the you know what's going on?
Yeah, yeah.
Right. It doesn't add up.
It's a conflict of interest. Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
So let's go back to something that you said. It kind of sounded like maybe part one of your series, the implication of Big Pharma in the plan itself.
Yeah.
There's a big social media movement right now, the hashtag the patent, right, on your hand as a cannabis user. How interesting is that the government owns the patent on a plant?
Well, actually, that's actually a great thing. I know a lot of people think it's a missed opportunity because they're like, why doesn't the government say it's medical if they have this patent? Well, you know, they have it's so institutionalized. The only way, realistically, this plan is going to be descheduled is if Congress does it.
Okay.
The executive, the president has to go through, has to convince too many people of too many agencies. Mm-hmm. The agencies aren't going to do it.
It's been this way for too long.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's going to go to, so number one, and I write this in my series, is patent. Patents are so important because that's how you make your money. That's how Big Pharma recoups its research and development money that it goes into drugs. It gets that money back and then a lot. Not just some, but a lot. So them having the patent just says to me it's not a bad thing because that could have orphan status, like a drug that no one really wants to put money into because there's really no benefit from them from it. It kind of just definitely takes the patent out of Big Pharma's hands if the government has it. So it's not a bad thing.
It's not like someone can have a monopoly on it, like what we're seeing with the EpiPen, episode here.
And that Pharma bro. Shirelli.
Yes, Martin Shariki.
Pronounce his last name.
Shariki, the homeboy is about to ghost face because he keeps pushing buttons that he shouldn't push.
Yeah.
It's
not what the advocates want, but I think that I think everyone who's learning about cannabis news needs to educate themselves, read articles on Big Pharma, how FDA does take something and make it into something that you'll find at CVS Pharmacy.
Yeah.
Because you're not going to see a plant at CVS and you're not going to see a pill at a dispensary.
No. Well, let's talk about the role of the FDA. It seems like there's been a bigger movement to call this plant medicine. And I definitely see medicinal purposes to the plant, but can that be a double-edged sword in the upcoming, political elections, political sphere, in the movement itself?
In the movement itself, yes. It's a new era. The Normal came out with a newsletter, and they said it's a new era. They have a shakeup going on, a lot of people changing positions up there at the Normal organization. So it is a new era, and I think that, moving it, the FDA's role. Sorry, what was the question? I have so much context that I like to put in these things.
Yeah,
I forget the original question.
This movement or this heavy kind of
On medicine. The medicine
to make it medicinal, and it is my medicine that I actually need, and a prescription, and all that stuff that goes into it.
I know it's really a simple way back a couple decades ago to say this. Pay attention. This is medicine. Medicine is medicine. Now that everything's coming to a head, more than half the states have medical cannabis. The people who have been advocating for medical. Making it medicine.
I think it was he got a little excited. The band.
Wow.
They kind of have to. I think they really should relook at what words they're using because they might have to. They're making their bed and they might have to lie in it. They don't want to because they're calling it medicine. Medicine is defined really, by what FDA says.
Through testing, through approvals.
FDA, and don't knock, the FDA, all government agents, is ridiculous, a lot of regulations, but FDA started because some pharmacy company a long time ago made a pill, made something, dissolved it in antifreeze as a new way to, to ingest it, and it killed 100 people.
Yeah.
And it was marketed as medicine, so that's why the FDA was formed. So you have to understand there's a lot at play here. It's not...
It seems like cannabis could really benefit from falling into where, and everyone's going to laugh at me, but this is how I see it, the vitamin category.
Supplements.
Yes.
They're excluded from a lot of things.
The supplement vitamin lobby has done an impressive job on making sure that they are readily available, identified, and over-the-counter. You know what I mean? And that is how I like my cannabis. Readily available, identified, and over-the-counter.
Hemp oil.
Yes,
those
absolutely.
Are all supplements.
CBDs. Yeah.
But if you put it in some states, if you put hemp oil or hemp seeds next to a bong or a paraphernalia, then it's no good.
Yep.
I know people are having issues with that here in Maryland.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right?
We've got a Meister who has a great store here in Washington, D.C. We've supported him.
Yes,
we've seen him at the Bud Summit and a bunch of other places, kind of ran into some issues. And we're rooting for him and his movement. I think he's still using the hashtag Free Meister, so we'll give him a big plug right there.
I saw it above his.
He's a good guy. Yeah, yeah, right over here on Georgia Avenue.
And so, you know, that's just stuff to, I mean, that's 10, 15 years down the road, some pharmaceutical grade. Cannabis-like molecule that would kind of make your body react as if it was on cannabis. But then it's not.
Yeah.
And there's so much work to be done. Mm-hmm. It's such a complex plan that they just don't know. There's the millions of dollars has not been put into it yet, the development.
Chloe, thank you so much. Stay with us through the break. We want to keep talking. I know you have a ton of information, a ton of stories. So thank you for being here. We'll take one quick commercial break right now. The Pink Fox Playhouse, this is episode 3 here in Washington, D.C. at Listen Vision Studios. I always wanted to say that, like, let's pause for station identification.
Sponsored by.
Like, you know, that's what they use to say the old Magic Games.
Love it. Okay, come up and get Red Rocks.
Welcome back. It's episode 3 of the Pink Fox Playhouse here at Listen Vision Studios, doing a quick selfie while we've got Chloe up here educating us really on the happenings of cannabis.
Dropping knowledge.
Yeah, current news, you know. And so some other interesting things. I did a story, BioTrack THC, leading software seed sale.
Okay.
Tracking, a lot of dispensaries and people use it. They just want, they're basically going to win Puerto Rico. The contract.
Oh, wow.
So they're going to be
wow.
doing Puerto Rico's medical.
No way.
Which is interesting because did you hear about the Microsoft getting involved in cannabis? Did you hear about
no.
that? No, I haven't heard that.
So Microsoft.
Oh, wow. Yes.
Wow.
They, so mainstream.
Yes.
They.
In every house.
It was, yeah, in every household. It was written that, it was reported that they teamed up with Kind Financial, which is
oh, sure, yeah,
seed to sale.
Mm-hmm. mm-hmm.
Honestly, if you read the fine print, it's they allowed them cloud space. I mean,
okay.
it's really
sure.
not. Okay. But everyone's
yeah.
making
but,
a big
but,
deal.
But it's a big step. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's progress for
it's good to have
mainstream.
Corporate acceptance of...
And BioTrack yeah. actually beat mm-hmm. them out. It's interesting because now we're going to international kind of dual language territories with mm-hmm. cannabis and... The Caribbean and all.
Oh,
you know,
sure, a lot so, happening in you know Jamaica. We saw yeah. Mighty Jamaica was just here
yeah.
at the Bud Summit last
they
week,
were great.
And they
were so nice.
Yeah, they yeah. were absolutely great.
People.
They've got a huge event taking place in December. I would urge you to check that out at Mighty Jamaica's website. Let's transition a little bit. I'm gonna be you know the Debbie Downer. I usually am of the group. Let's talk about a tougher story that just happened. Cannabis and guns, gun owners in particular. Let's talk about.
I don't really meet that many. Cannabis users that like to,
you know have yeah shoot them
you know,
up.
Shoot them up. No, you're
well,
not,
it doesn't
not really
seem
going to the gun
like
range.
They don't
norm.
Really go with
yeah.
each other. That's more of a cocaine, you know, in guns combination.
Yeah,
smoking a pancake, you know.
40s, I don't know.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Don't
try that at home.
There was a current event just recently, or a current story just recently. A young woman applied for a license, I believe.
Yeah, for a gun.
Or applied for a gun. Yeah, excuse me. Through legal means.
It is a license. It is an application.
Yep.
To go through
mm-hmm.
Federally.
Yeah, absolutely.
And she went, it was in Nevada, and she has a medical marijuana card, mm-hmm. and she was denied the gun because on the ATF register, on the form mm-hmm. of the firearm form, it asks question E, do you use marijuana or do you have a medical card? And if you check yes, you've just admitted to using a Schedule I substance, which
oh,
is
wow.
very illegal.
Yeah.
And
you just admitted to a felony, which is insane.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and Explosives, that's an awesome bureau, by
yeah.
the way.
Sounds
they,
like a lot of fun.
They had an open letter to all of their gun shop owners.
Wow.
You cannot sell to people that admit to using or having a medical marijuana card.
So,
and this woman, the kicker, doesn't use. She's just a supporter of the movement.
That's insane.
Here's my question about that. Was marijuana the only Schedule I substance that they asked about?
That's a good question.
Well, the only substance you can get a card to legally use. You know what I mean?
Right, but I mean, like, while we're at it, like, I mean, because it seems like, well, if hypothetically, I'm just popping eight balls all day and I want to go get a gun.
And so I was
like, I'm not asked about that.
I was going to mention this. So the reason I moved up to Washington, D.C. was I got a job with the Department of Defense. And at that time, I had to go through a lengthy background check. And they asked what my drug usage was. And I was very honest with them, I think much to their shock, you know, when I sat down with them, that I had checked the box CX.
What
yes,
haven't
and,
you tried?
Yeah, no, I mean, like, I didn't have a long list of things that I had tried, but I was like, yeah, man, I, you know, we smoked weed, you know, and
were you, like, sitting there asking for more boxes?
Well, no, but, like, I told the guy, too, I was like, and my girlfriend, like, did cocaine at the time, so I was doing what she did, like, because I liked having sex with her, so, yeah.
Wow.
Like,
this has got very real.
No, because he was like,
entered a new
why are you
area
doing these
for the playhouse.
No, it was like, why are you doing those things? They have
new.
No.
You weren't seeking it out.
No.
So you're like, it's okay. It was coming to me.
Yeah, like, and it was like, well, so what are your future plans with drug use? And it's like, I have no future
plans.
You know what
well,
I mean?
Well, unless it involves
no,
someone
I mean,
you want to have
pull
sex
out a date
with
book and
then,
been like, well.
Apparently the rules change.
Yeah.
If Riri calls, I have lots of them, you know? But it's really interesting that she ran into that problem with the guns. We just saw a segment on Weedekit on Vice where a mom ran into a similar issue. She's a medical marijuana user. Her kids were taken away by CPA.
That's a big problem.
It's insane. So now her kids are in protective custody because she's using medical cannabis legally.
It's the difference between federal and state laws. Can't, you know, and people will interpret it the way they want. And if they want to come at you that way from a federal perspective, they can get that way and pin you down. But, you know, it's a terrible thing. And as far as the gun denial goes, I was talking to Judge Shelley Hayes is a former circuit judge in Illinois. Met her at the D.C. Bud Summit. Mm-hmm. Lovely woman.
Absolutely, yeah.
And she was a judge, and she's a lawyer now. And she said it is bizarre to how do you correlate marijuana use with violence and, you know, craziness? Mm-hmm. Like it doesn't necessarily who made that.
You have to
there
live in
no
that
correlation.
You have to live in that reefer madness mentality.
It's basically,
you know,
that movie.
It's made. It's assumed. It's propagandized. There is no clinical. So. There is nothing between. You know. A user, how can you assume that they are going to just
violent tendencies
and yeah, so it's still to
well to I would like the NRA to start protecting the rights of cannabis users as well as others, because
they've got
they
lots
get a
of
lot
money.
Of money,
yeah,
and
they
do a lot of
money.
Work for gun rights, so they should maybe think about this.
Yeah, they haven't really had a statement or stepped up. They're just staying out of it.
The last thing they want to do is make another statement. They are so tired of making statements, you know.
That's their job.
I know. Oh, that's all they fucking do.
Well, it'll be interesting to see what side of the law cannabis comes down on in the future. Is it going to be like alcohol, or is it going to be like, you know, something? Is it going to be alcohol in that, like, if someone drinks a fifth of whatever,
we can gauge
and beats their significant other, God forbid, you know, that significant other can't sue Jack Daniels.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. So. Mm. We're seeing that right now. If you eat an edible or if you smoke and you do something terrible because maybe you lived a life that led to those decisions. I mean, I don't know, not necessarily the cannabis plant making you do it. Will you get in trouble? Will the edibles manufacturer get in trouble? We don't know yet. Will it be like tobacco or will it be like alcohol?
Mm-hmm.
Tobacco, you can sue Philip Morris. Like if you have the
wrongful termination or like getting sick and
right,
that's
proven cases.
Yeah.
But you can't go after the alcohol manufacturer. And that's what cannabis companies are hoping.
I want to go back to something you said about the difference between state and federal laws. A couple weeks ago, we saw the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals come back and tell the Justice Department they are no longer allowed to prosecute individuals who live in a state with a medical cannabis program. As a reporter, as a writer, as someone who's covering, you know, the trends, what's something like that mean to you guys, to the world?
Yeah, it was so that the DEA, what do you mean, like the August announcements that, you can't, well, they weren't going to reschedule.
They weren't going to reschedule, but the...
And it was a decision out of the...
The Ninth Circuit Court...
Down. In San Francisco.
Yeah, and then the Court of Appeals said that the Justice Department cannot spend any more money prosecuting individuals. Live in
because
a state with a medical program.
Ahead. Companies were saying, oh, that was just for companies and cannabis industries. Mm-hmm. And now, you know, and so, like I said... It depends. Some people, for whatever reason, their old school thought or their insecurities or their financial insecurities, that they have to come at people from this you know, elevated level for no reason, thinking they're better than them and using federal law to like twist the law, the words and coming at people saying, you know, they're testing everything, every step of the way. So. It's an ongoing battle, but it's a great win for advocates and for because if they could prove, you know, that it was also individuals, that's huge. About 10 or 20 years, you know, 10 years ago, that wouldn't have been the case. Supreme Court, there was one. So Scalia recently died this year.
Yeah.
He was in the Supreme Court. And he is a very constitutionalist by the Constitution, state right, very Republican that way, conservative. And there was a case in California a long time ago, and he did not side on the state rights side, like when there was a huge bust
A big raid. Okay.
And he didn't side on the side of individual. He didn't side on the side of state. So that was decades ago. So we've come a long way.
Sure. Sure.
Yeah, so I think it's a good thing.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today.
Yeah,
we got
you.
The exclusive
you.
About your three-piece that we should look for. Where should we keep an eye out
yeah.
for that?
The Marijuana Times.
Okay.
MarijuanaTimes.org. I have, you can go to my page, like under author, and I have all of, there's a quick link to all of my, I have like 100 stories up.
Oh
my
God.
Are they on your blog?
January.
Are they linked on your blog?
So I have a link on my website as well.
Well, let's get all that. Where can we follow you? Where can we find you?
Oh, all the things.
Yeah.
Chloe Canna News.
Okay.
So it's ChloeCannaNews, one word. That's on Instagram and Twitter.
Nice.
And on Facebook, Chloe Summers. You'll find me on my page. And yeah, I've just really enjoyed being with you guys. Thanks for
talking. Thanks for having us. Yeah. Keep up the great work. We love following you. We love reading the stories. So
and I look forward to the Greenlight Festival.
Yes, that's going to take place on Monday. We hope to be there. We're in the midst of an office construction project right now. So it's busy times over at Pink Fox HQ. But we hope to be out there on Monday.
Well, you were the first people at the DC Bud Summit. You were the first table, so I can understand that you're a little tired.
Yeah.
Still from that.
Well, and
did a great job holding down the
thank you
floor.
It was a great day.
Yeah.
That was such a great day. In the next segment, stay with us. We'll be announcing and giving a highlight to where you can find Pink Fox upcoming next.
Yeah, and enjoy some Red Rocks.
Yeah, in the meantime, one quick commercial break and then we'll be right back. Thanks again. Right. Wrapping up on the third episode of the Pink Fox Playhouse here. Thank you so much, everyone who joined us in the studio. Thank you to our guest, Chloe. Make sure to go
thank
follow
you,
her.
Chloe.
Read those articles. Get involved. Like she said, check out Normal. Check out your local organization, Women Grow, NCIA, the National Cannabis Industry Association. There are great people out there that you know need help, need your support. So
lots of resources, lots of information on
absolutely.
Those places.
Get out there and get the movement going.
Get active.
So, Pink Fox is going to be at the Freedom Rally in Boston, September 16th and 18th, or
17th and 18th.
Is it the 17th and
18th? We just leave on the 16th.
Oh, okay. So we've got a dry erase board. It's got all these important dates on there. I try to keep those dates in my head and on my phone. But we will be at the Freedom Rally, headlined by Method Man and Red Man, up in Boston at the Boston Commons. If you're going to be there, please stop by and check us out. We would love to see you and
if
say hello.
If you have friends there, tell them to
send
stop
them our
by
way.
And visit their DC friends.
Speaking of festivals, music festivals, real quick as we wrap up. Last week, I know you want to just give a big shout out to My Morning Jacket.
Oh man, they played a great show at Lock-In. It was super long. It was like 2 hours, 45 minutes. They
did a couple covers.
They did like four, you could say five if you count Jim James solo work, but Burt Bacharach, remember? What the World Needs Now. And they did David Bowie, Prince, and
Bob Marley.
And Bob Marley.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which
Purple Rain.
Purple Rain. Yeah.
Purple Rain.
Yeah. Yeah. And they had
Rebel
to.
Rebel yeah. by Bowie. And Could You Be Loved, Bob Marley.
That's wonderful. That's wonderful.
Yeah, it was great. And then they played a lot of their great music, and I really wished I could have been there, but it was awesome to be able to sit on my couch in my living room and watch the
their live
stream
shows are crazy
on my big screen.
So. I saw them in Memphis a few years back.
So
and that was, that was they, a wild
so
show.
Fun.
They put on a good show.
They're so fun. And the Focus Towel came out on Lalo.
Yes.
They put on a good show. Another good show, the Pink Fox Playhouse. Thank you all for being here on the third episode. follow us at PinkFox202 across social media. PinkFox202.com is the website. Thank you to our producer, Mike Phillips. Mike, where can we find you?
DJ Mike Phillips with a Z.
DJ Mike Phillips with a Z. That's PHILLIPZ. Ronan, where can we find you?
On SoundCloud. Ronan, RONIN.
And Ronan, today's music was made by?
Ronan.
Oh! Dude, that was great. Thank you so much for sharing that with us today. That was, I mean,
that was
honestly,
really
it was
thank you.
It was very, very good, man. I can't wait to hear it on the radio.
Love to do it. All right.
Absolutely. Thank you, guys. Thank you for everyone
thanks.
In the studio.
Thanks, everybody.
We will see you guys soon. Thank you for joining us, Pink Fox Playhouse. Thank you, Jeremy Beaver. Thank you, Listen Vision Studios.
Bye.